Hello, everyone. Good evening and good morning to Andrea, who's joining us from the US, and those of you like him who are joining us from other time zones. Welcome to this Ofcom special session. Today, we're going to discuss the economic rationale for public service broadcasting and public service media in the digital age. My name is Luisa Fuso, and I am the chief economist at Ofcom. As some of you might know, Ofcom is the UK's media and telecoms regulator. And recently, the UK government announced that Ofcom is going to become the regulator for online content in the UK. Now, as we see an increasing convergence of all the sectors we regulate and the move online of media services, this has created an increasing need for a holistic and a rethink, if you like, of how we regulate our media sectors. Amongst the powers that we have in this space, Ofcom is responsible for making recommendations to government about public service broadcasting and how to strengthen it, to preserve media plurality. And recently, alongside the Competition and Markets Authority, the government has asked Ofcom to work on a review on news sustainability. So really some fundamental questions as we observe an increasing disruption to the traditional business models that both public service broadcasting and quality news have relied upon. As we know, as economists, some of the PSB content, as well as high quality news, are public goods, and they matter hugely for our democracy and our civil society. So as the traditional business models that we have relied upon for their provision are now disrupted, the question really is what will replace them and how can we regulate them? And in particular, as regards broadcasting, we have observed a move from linear to video on demand and consumption of online content, as well as the reliance on connected television, which really raise a fundamental threat for our public service broadcasting. As regards news, we now see the provision of disaggregated news through online platforms, which again has undermined the traditional model, which relied on advertising support for quality journalism. So phenomenal challenges. And today we have a brilliant panel with us to help try and understand a little bit better the rationale for these services in a digital age. And what do we need to do to ensure that the public good elements of these services is preserved. So I'm going to introduce the panelists in the order in which they will be speaking. First, we will be covering PSB, and our first speaker is Dr. Helen Weeds. Helen advises on competition and regulatory inquiries, mainly in the communications and digital sectors, as Director of Multimedia Economics and the Senior Consultant at CRA. She is Honorary Senior Research Fellow at Imperial College Business School and previously held academic posts at Oxford, Cambridge, Warwick, and Essex. She has acted as advisor to the House of Commons DCMS Select Committee, to the National Infrastructure Commission, and to various regulatory authorities. Helen is then followed by Kira Kalmas. Kira is an economics director at Ofcom. She specializes on broadcasting, and she is the economics director who is currently leading our public service broadcasting review. Kira has extensive experience as an economist on competition policy and regulation. And prior to joining Ofcom in 2011, she was an economic consultant with Compass Lexicon. Kira has background degrees in economics from Oxford and the LSE. We then moved to focus on information and news with Professor Andrea Pratt. Andrea is Richard Paul Richmond Professor of Business at Columbia Business School and Professor of Economics at the Department of Economics at Columbia University. Prior to Columbia, he taught at Tilburg and at the LSE. His work focuses on organizational economics and political economy. His current research in organizational economics explores issues such as organizational design, corporate leadership, employee motivation, and optimal disclosure. His current research in political economy attempts to define and measure the influence of the media industry on the democratic process. And last but not least, Professor Gregory Crawford is Professor of Economics at the University of Zurich and former co-director of the Industrial Organization Program at the CEPR. Greg is an empirical economist specializing in the field of industrial organization, antitrust, competition policy, and media economics. His research interests include vertical integration and foreclosure, bargaining, public service broadcasting, regulation, and advertising. In 2007 and 2008, Greg was chief economist at the Federal Communications Commission, the FCC, the US Media and Communications Regulator. So each speaker is going to give a 15 minutes presentation, and we are aiming to keep about 20 minutes at the end of the session to address all the questions from the audience. Please submit your questions in the Ask the Question button on the right-hand side of your screen. So that's all the background out of the way. And without further ado, Helen, over to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Louisa. And thank you to Ofcom for organizing this special session. And I'm delighted to be speaking at the RES conference. So as Louisa just flagged up, I'm going to talk about the economic rationale for public service broadcasting in this sort of digital online world that we now find ourselves in. Quick overview. I'll start by just talking about what public service broadcasting is and how it's delivered, focusing on the UK. Then I'll turn to the economics of public service broadcasting. What's the rationale for having it at all? And how do those rationales apply now that we're in this so-called digital age? As I'll say, there's sort of two main categories of concern to consider. One is consumer market failures, and the other is what you might call, and Ofcom has previously called, citizen concerns. So the role that TV can play in promoting educational and social values, and in particular, the role of news, which is the topic that both Andrea and Greg will pick up on later. So, introductory, what is public service broadcasting? Well, being in the UK, we tend to start with the mission statement that John Rees, the founding director general of the BBC, set out in the 1920s, which is to inform, educate, and entertain. Now, that's sort of all very nice. It's nice and succinct. The Communications Act 2003, which forms the legal basis for this whole system, writes things in a much more long-winded way. So I've paraphrased here. So sort of in summary, PSB aims to provide programs covering a wide range of subject matters that satisfy many different audiences. Educational programming is a particular priority. It aims to provide a comprehensive, authoritative coverage of news and current affairs, and sort of generally to maintain high standards in content and in the production quality. So not just what the content is about, but how it's done too. Now, many people looking at the PSB system tend to think immediately of the BBC. And obviously the BBC is our flagship sort of national public broadcaster. It's very much what we think about in this context. However, the UK system of PSB is actually a very mixed model of provision. So for reference, Channel 4 is also a PSB. S4C, if you're in Wales, the Welsh language channel. The Channel 3 licensees, which are ITV in England and Wales, STV in Scotland, and UTV in Northern Ireland, and Channel 5, those are all PSBs. So the last of those last two categories there tend to get overlooked somewhat because people see them rather differently being commercial organisations, but they are in fact PSBs. The ownership is mixed. So we have public organisations, so-called statutory corporations, the BBC, Channel 4 and S4C, and then private commercial companies, ITV, STV, UTV, and also Channel 5. So these are private companies, they have a profit maximisation motive, but they've bought into this system by having a PSB licence, which gives them obligations to provide the kinds of programming and standards mentioned above. And they do it in return for certain benefits. Which brings me to the issue of funding. How is all this provided? Again, people tend to think immediately of the TV licence fee, just gone up to £159 a year. That money goes mainly to the BBC. A small part goes to S4C, and occasionally bits are creamed off for certain other purposes, like providing broadband. There's a very small direct government grant which goes to S4C, so I believe that's being phased out. And then all of the PSBs other than the BBC carry advertising, so they earn money from advertising. The commercial ones and Channel 4 rely entirely on advertising revenue to fund their services. Note that because the PSBs have prominence on the EPG or Electronic Programme Guide, as well as this helping them serve their public service mission, which is obviously a primary aim, purpose of having it, it also does help boost their advertising revenue because viewers tend to find them more easily and watch them more often. Just as an additional factor on the DTT, digital terrestrial system, the PSBs are gifted their spectrum or they obtain it at lower fees for Channel 3 and Channel 5. So if you like, there's a subsidy to their costs in that way. So turning to the economics of all of this, why do we have this system? So Ofcom in previous PSB reports has divided up the sort of two categories here quite neatly into consumer market failures. I would characterize this as the question, will the market deliver the content that people themselves want to watch? And we need to think here particularly about diversity of content. Do we have the content that meets especially minority and niche tastes? And then the quality of programming as well. Historically, this has been a major concern that a purely privately provided programming might not meet these aims. The second set of rationales for PSB are so-called citizenship concerns. And I could sum this up as content we'd like everybody else to watch because it does good for all of us. So this is particularly clear with educational programming. Do you think that's generally a good thing? Programming that promotes social values and social cohesion. And a particular element here, democratic concerns, voter information, the way that the political process works and the role of the media in that. And this is an area that Andrea and Greg will pick up on later. In economic terms, we can think about these citizenship concerns as positive externalities. The viewing of such content generates a benefit beyond the viewer themselves. But this then raises two issues. We know when there are positive externalities associated with a certain product, the provision of it will tend to be too low. So here, all these worthy forms of educational, socially valuable, or voter informing programming will tend to be underprovided. But there's also a second question, which is very important, and I think particularly relevant now in the digital world, which is the consumption side. It's all very well producing this programming, but if nobody watches it, then the positive externalities aren't realized. So we really need to ask the question, will this programming actually be watched and generate all these wider benefits that we care about? So what's happening? What do we mean by digitization in this sector? I tend to think primarily about the consumption side here. And so if we go back to, well, my childhood, it's the world on the left-hand side of my slide, old-style television with just a limited range of channels. Actually, in my childhood, there was only the BBC and ITV. Then along in my teens came Channel 4, and then latterly Channel 5 that wasn't even available to the whole country anyway. So very limited choice. Then with digitization, that's done two things. I mean, both within the terrestrial or airwave broadcast systems, it gets called in various different countries, massive expansion in the number of channels that can simultaneously be carried. So huge expansion there, but also a proliferation in platforms, different ways of accessing television. Since the sort of 1980s, 1990s in the UK, we've had cable and satellite television. Those could carry many more channels than the terrestrial system. And with digitization, those can carry up to 500 channels.